Our guest today is Penny Power. She's an entrepreneur, author, and public speaker. She's also been awarded an OBE by the Queen for her contribution to entrepreneurship in the social digital sector. She was the founder of eCademy, one of the early professional networking platforms, which came before LinkedIn, Facebook, and Twitter. She ran that company for over a decade. She now mentors groups of people, has written 2 books. And if you're interested in finding out more about Penny, you can go to pennypower.co.uk. If you'd like to book her to speak at your event or within your organization, she's represented by stellar speakers. Also, the sponsor of this podcast is the European Hemp Company. Listeners of this podcast can get £10 off their CBD oil as well as free shipping by using the code BenLowreyPodcast at checkout. Just go to europeanhempcompany.co.uk. Also, I'm a member of a property investing joint venture group, which is coached and mentored by Alex Louise Thomas in South Wales. If you're interested in finding out more about that and seeing some of the videos, go to financialfreedomfilms.com. If you'd like to be a guest on this podcast, or if you know somebody that would make a great guest, you can direct them to benlowrey.com/podcast guest. And if you'd like to sponsor the podcast, go to benlowrey.com/sponsorship. So, Penny Power, welcome to the podcast. How are you doing today?
I'm very well, Ben. Lovely to be here with you.
Now, unfortunately, you did not qualify to come on this podcast because you can't do a handstand.
I used to be able to, and I think with a bit of practice, you never know.
But because of your extensive work in the entrepreneurial field, I made an exception for you, and here we are.
That's very good of you.
So, you've got a new book out.
I have. Thank you for asking. Yeah. Business is personal.
Yeah. Okay. So tell us about that then.
Well, and I think your audience is mostly entrepreneurs. Am I right?
Yes. We're high performance people. Yeah.
Mm. I like that. So how many of them have had people say it's not personal, it's just business? And I think in a way, some of us, depending on our own sense of confidence, self-worth, etc., might actually get taken in by that. And I, to a certain extent, did. I had an investor 6 years ago who, in a second business after Academy, who said that to me. She was quite an intimidating lady. And she said, I don't need to like you, Penny. It's not personal. It's just business. I wish I could turn back time, and you shouldn't ever wish that, I know, but go back to that and say it's actually incredibly personal. I put my life into this. I, you know, it's all my passion, my time, my thinking, my day, my dreams. And it is very personal to me, because actually the reality is that it wasn't a good relationship that I held with that investor, which is never good for a business. Mm. And I think we have to be able to stand in our own space and say, this is really personal. And I think emotions and passion are really a huge part of being an entrepreneur. I think when you lose your mojo, when you don't feel it's personal, is when the business starts to lose a sense of excitement, and your customers and clients and will feel it. So to me, it is very personal.
So you're saying we're going to be more effective in business if we treat people like people, as opposed to just associates and numbers on a spreadsheet. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, I wrote a blog actually on eCademy when we launched our blogging in the early 2000s, called Emotional Wealth Leads to Financial Wealth. And it was really interesting at those times. So this was before LinkedIn, I think it's 2.5-3 years before Facebook launched, when we were still in that very stiff world of handshakes and going to networking events and just discussing what we are, not who we are, and not really engaging with people. Still the world of, you know, flashing our business cards around. And in that blog, it was quite interesting how many people were comfortable with it and how many people challenged me. But now, you know, since then, so I think that was 2001, so we're talking 18 years on, and a massive shift in engagement and culture and expectations and stress and the connected world and how online, how we spend a lot of time in our life online. There's no doubt about it that people who are more engaging, more honest and raw and real, and don't go forward with just their ego, are doing really well. And and that's what we always have believed in eCademy. And I think we still are in a massive shift. I don't think everybody gets it. But in my book, I was very raw and real. And it's been really interesting the experience since I launched it in that January, the type of people have come towards me. And there's a set, you know, a lot of people, Ben, don't they say, you know, I became an entrepreneur, or I wanted my own business because I wanted freedom. You know, I think that's a value, isn't it, that people want. And they mean, you know, freedom of time, financial freedom, autonomy over their own decisions. But I think the ultimate form of freedom is when we are ourselves and we respect ourselves, we accept ourselves, and we put ourselves forward. And I think that's what the world's asking for now, in a world of fake, where we don't know who to trust.
Let me just jump back to the beginning of your story. So you created a platform, and I kind of recognize the name, but I'm not really familiar. So tell us about that. What happened?
Ben, how old are you? Because that's not a derogatory question.
I'm 36.
Right, okay. So what I started in 98. How old were you then?
I'd have been about 15 or so then.
Awesome. So I was 33. Yeah. So I'm 55 now. So in 98, so I'd been in the IT industry since I was 19, and I had stopped working at an ambitious level to have my children when I was 28. And it was just as the dot-com world was emerging, and it was all about e-commerce and e-procurement. But you had communities like Friends Reunited. Mm-hmm. And MySpace.
Yeah.
You remember those?
Yeah.
And but there was nothing in the space for business. It was 2002 that LinkedIn launched, 2004 that Facebook launched, 2006 that Twitter launched. And as I've always been a very relationship-driven person, and since meeting Thomas, my husband, Thomas Power, when I was 24, and learning...
Your name really is Penny Power.
It is. I'm not that big a dickhead that I would make that up.
Okay.
Did you think that?
Well, I don't know. I mean, it's too cool a name, isn't it? It's a superhero name. I presumed it was a, what do you call it, avatar, you know, what's a nickname?
Oh, God, I really need to say that on my website, don't I? This is a real name. So I met Thomas when I was, funnily enough, he was in my diary, Thomas Power, for about 3 months before we met. And I remember joking with my sales manager, that'd be a cool name if I fancied this chap.
Why was he in your diary?
Because he owned a telemarketing company.
Okay.
And I had the budget for a lot of money because I was working for a distributor of IT products and services, and we were an £80 million company as a sales and marketing director. So I held a budget. Large companies at the time had what were called cooperative funds. So when I bought, I don't know, £30 million worth of printers from Hewlett-Packard, you would get a percentage back to spend on marketing. Mm. And he was after my marketing money.
Oh.
And then he was after me.
Right.
So Thomas taught me about networking. I'd never heard the phrase. I'd never understood what it meant. But I watched his unconditional attitude towards people. When I was 33 in 1998, I said to Thomas, you know, couldn't we build a community for business owners online and apply all your incredible attitude towards networking into that and enable us to create a global community of friends in business? And that's what we did. So that's long story behind why we started Academy.
So you started Academy, what year was that? What, roughly?
98.
98, right. So that really was before what we know now as all the social media platforms. That was really early.
Was, and really scarily early, because we had to educate. And many of your listeners, your entrepreneurs, will see a gap in a market and try and fill it. And it's exciting to be evangelizing a new concept, but it also is extremely hard because you're educating the market. And we were educating the market on how to behave and build their brands and use tools that enabled them to build personal reputation online.
So what happened with it? Is it still running?
No. So this is where I get a glass of red wine and ask you to sit me on a sofa and you give me a therapy session.
Okay.
Painful. So what happened in the end was so Reid Hoffman was on our platform. He's the founder of LinkedIn, and he was not that active, but he was a lurker. And he went to Silicon Valley and raised a lot of money. He raised $330 million from people all over the world, from Russia, China, all over the world, clever man at raising money. And I have to say, I think raising money for a business is the hardest thing you ever have to do. Mm-hmm. But what it gives you is it gives you the ability to design a business model that allows scale, and it also allows you to bring in incredible talent. We were very organically growing. We were charging £10, $10, €10 a month for people to be able to network on our site. We had a free element, but it was more of a lurking. You know, you could read blogs. You could, but if you wanted to actually be active, we wanted to verify you through a credit card and know that you were who you say you were. We took a lot of store by trust and making sure that people treated one another very well and the culture of it. Anyway, ultimately, to cut a long story short, then so LinkedIn started in 2002, Facebook in 2004, Twitter in 2006. In 2008, we were really feeling that biting us because people wanted us to be free. And so when we were churning, which is natural, people leave communities, not as many people coming in because they didn't know how gorgeous it was before they joined. And they were wondering, why would I have to pay for Academy? So we went to a bank and said, could we have a 5-year loan to pivot the business into a model that we didn't really believe in, which was a free model, which would mean we would need to sell your data. We would need to have advertising and do what people are now very uncomfortable about. So, of course, the existing members were very unhappy about that because they were happy to pay. But we were trying to get this engine, this machine to survive. We came up with lots of other business revenue generators around the edges. Anyway, 3 years into the loan being paid off and us starting to see the business model working, the bank in the banking crisis called in our loan with only 2 years notice, 2 years left to run. So they expected us to pay it off straight away in 30 days notice. It was impossible. By then, Thomas and I had already sold our house. We had no leverage there. We had worked ourselves into the ground. We didn't have enough money coming into the business to really employ the sort of people we needed. So we were working extremely hard. Three young kids. We wanted to maintain their education. It was just hard. I can't explain. Anybody who's been through something like this will understand it. Your brain goes into overwhelm. You just, you know, you try and make the best decisions you can. But we had this period and we went around London trying to get investors at a time when there was no way we could get investors at that time during the banking crisis. So somebody then bought it for £1 from us, which meant we weren't having to pay back that final loan, but it meant we no longer had our baby.
I see. And at the peak, when it was really going, like how many years was it running from start?
14 years.
Oh, a long time, long time. Yeah. And at the peak, presumably, it was doing really well at one point, was it? Did you add staff and stuff?
Yeah, it was phenomenal, Ben. It was a beautiful business. I can't say that I ever rested in my bed. You know, we had what I call in my book a money monster under our bed because we had done what a lot of entrepreneurs done. We'd put our own life on edge to build the business, and that meant that rather than the business strain being in an office, the business strain was under our bed, thumping away every night at us, keeping us awake. We also had a lot of, we'd created a culture of a massive amount of engagement. So the members wanted, and we felt we wanted to be those leaders to engage with us a lot. So, you know, on all the platforms everywhere, people were talking to us, which did enable us to create a personal brand. And it's really our personal brands that has enabled us to go forward and build other things and maintain a really nice business life, because Penny Power and Thomas Power, I think, are trusted in the markets, people that really care about entrepreneurs. So that's good.
And how many users did it have at its peak?
650,000. There were more people reading it because we hugely optimized people's content. So at the time, search engine optimization, we were the best at that because we had the largest business blog. And therefore, the optimization, when anybody put in some keywords, an Academy profile would come out the top.
I see.
So our members loved it for that. So that meant a lot of people would be reading the site and visiting the site, millions and millions. And members would constantly be telling us that they had won business from somebody who wasn't an Academy member, but they'd visited their site, picked up some details from their profile, and they had exchanged communication outside of Academy.
And clearly you've made it clear there was an emotional impact on you, the loss of that business. And can you tell us a bit more about that?
Yeah, I'd be happy to. So we didn't have time to have closure in our hearts about it because we were in massive scarcity. And scarcity takes you into fear-based decisions. We had three children. We needed to keep a roof over their head, obviously, and we wanted to keep in their education. We didn't want to disrupt that at the stages that they were in their education. So we had a lot of financial burden, massive debt, personal debt, massive, because we had, at one point, a bank was going to buy Academy, and we'd gone through the 9 months of due diligence. And so we personally were keeping the business going through that process. So we had massive personal debt, and I think we didn't really even allow us time to consider how our mental health was. But it wasn't, I don't think it was great, because of, you know, you make decisions that maybe like that one I started off saying, you know, I went into a second business with somebody who didn't treat me very well, and my self-worth and desperation and scarcity was low enough for me just to accept it. What happened was we had a lot of personal challenges, not only financial ones, which led upon led. So everybody would identify many of them. My mum had dementia, and that was very challenging. My brother got pancreatic cancer and died. My sister lost her daughter to cancer in an 8 week diagnosis period. And then our beautiful daughter Hannah, which many people are following her online now, was abducted by three men in a car and raped by one of them.
What?
And so on top of financial stress and keeping ourselves going and needing to turn up to speeches and needing to turn up to client opportunities in the best possible way, we were putting oxygen on a lot of other people to keep them okay, like our daughter and our sister and my brother and my everything we could do, but at the same time needing to present a strong face to the market. And that wasn't presenting a fake face, I have to say that. But I think our online image was a lot glossier than the reality. And this is what prompted me to write my book, because in November the 30th, 17, I did a crowdfund campaign to bring a business to market that's dear to my heart called The Business Cafe, which is a concept of a cafe on the high street for business people to pop into and feel a sense of belonging and community and get help. In that cafe culture, where do you go? At the moment, we go to Costa or Starbucks. We sit on our own. And I was doing a crowdfund because I didn't want to get a large investor. I experienced that and regretted it. And I wanted the members to own this cafe so that it was community owned. And halfway into the crowdfund on a crowdfunding platform, Crowdcube, one of our previous trolls came in and started to really damage my reputation on there. And unfortunately, investors who didn't know me started to withdraw the money. What I didn't realize is that triggered something, which in the end was the diagnosis was PTSD. And so on December the 1st, 2017, about 15 months ago, I started to have go to a psychologist and ended up also going into group therapy. And in that, I learned an amazing amount about the emotional fitness that a business owner needs to have. And that's why I wrote my book, because I think if I'd gone back in time, rather than just acquiring skills and knowledge and a network, I would have spent a lot more time before I really became an entrepreneur and as I was going through the early journey, to understand my own mental vulnerabilities, my character, my personality, triggers, dealing with some things that I had to toughen up, and also respecting the boundaries where that was who I was.
At what point in the timeline did you have that second business that you mentioned with the troublesome business partner? Was that before you wrote the book?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, it was. I wrote my book last year.
The first book?
Oh, the first book, Know Me, Like Me, Follow Me, I wrote in 2009. Now, that was before.
Oh, I see. So there, yeah. Right. So there was a book either side of that.
Yeah. And then the second book, Business is Personal, I wrote and published this year and wrote it last year. So, this term mental fitness is very important to me, because mental health, when I heard people talking about mental health, I used to think, as I'm sure most people do, I'm glad I haven't got a mental health problem. And I would think, you know, I haven't got bipolar, I haven't got depression, I haven't got anxiety. I would think, and I would bless myself for the fact that I was that lucky. I wasn't mentally fit, though.
There's okay, what's the difference?
So, well, I might be physically fit, right? And therefore that ensures my mental health is maintained as a good a level by being physically fit. And I think you need to be mentally fit so that you maintain your mental health.
I see. Oh, I see. Yes, that makes sense.
So mental fitness is a very personal thing, and I write it in my book. It's very personal. Emotional fitness is very mental. Emotional health is personal. Mental health is personal, as is spiritual and physical health. And in a world where we're so connected and we look over our shoulders, or metaphorically because of our shoulders, but we look online and compare ourselves with others, and subconsciously we're despairing that we lack, you know, I'm not doing that everybody else is doing, I'm not as amazing as that person, I've just seen a holiday photo of this beautiful family and I've not got that. We compare ourselves all the time, and it erodes our mental fitness, I think, mental health, because we start to feel we lack, we can get quite low. And I think we have to learn personal responsibility to that. And in my book, the strapline is, be the leader of the life and business you want. Because if you actually went under the covers of all these people that we're admiring and believing and trusting and think have these incredible lives, everybody has their story. And so when I do my speaking and in my book, I'm trying to get this to be a lot more real and raw about the reality. Because entrepreneurship isn't always easy. And I mean, the average sole trader is doing about 27,000 a year. You know, we see these people that hire big houses for a day and hire a Ferrari for the day and even borrow a suit from a top suit maker, stand outside them and say, you can be as successful as me. And that's saying you're not successful enough. And we just have to have more personal responsibility for the way that we handle our mental fitness and get a real deep sense of the amazing person we are. And that's down to self-worth. And so when I was going through a lot of my troubles, my daughter said to me, Mum, I don't understand why you don't believe in yourself more. You know, you've got an OBE, you've done all this, you have really nice people saying nice things to you. And I said, well, that's external validation. I have to get the validation inside. I have to be able to feel I'm worthy. And then that comes down to a reasonable amount of work to look at, why do we have our self-worth eroded over time? And our self-worth is about how we value ourselves. And if we don't value ourselves well enough, we don't negotiate in business as well as we could. We don't create the right boundaries around us. And it's just so important.
How deep do you have to dig? Is it a case of going back to all the childhood stuff and all the therapy work? Like, what do you recommend for people?
So the first thing I say is, and it's very important, this is, I'm a torchbearer on this. I might be a benchmark for others rather than an expert. And I would say I have, when I'm coaching or people on my mastermind, I've got a very good way of helping people to consider this subject. But I haven't done the extraordinary work that psychologists and very powerfully trained business coaches might have done. I think I would say to anybody that's looking at this, be very careful about how you start digging around in your brain. Because there are a lot of amateurs out there that could expose and trigger you, and then you don't know how to close that wound properly. So to me, it's as dangerous as open heart surgery or brain surgery.
This is beyond sort of business and entrepreneurial stuff. This is fundamental psychology stuff, isn't it? Emotional stuff. This is core work you're describing.
It is. I mean, what I ask people to do when I'm coaching them or on the mastermind is at least start to consider moments over the next couple of weeks that you can write down where for some reason something triggered something in you. Or that you did something that you wish you'd had the confidence to do. So a lot of people, a lot of entrepreneurs speak for free, and that's not part of their business model. It's very few people can afford to just do things for free. They go and have coffee so people can pick their brain for free. And they're using up valuable time in their business time. Now, they might get a sense of self-worth that at least somebody wants me. But actually, if you're a business person, you need to have your values a little bit higher than that around your self-worth. So I would say start understanding your triggers. Now, I can chat to people about my experience, and hopefully, you know, today might help that when we're talking this through with people. But if it's very deep, I think it is good to talk to a psychologist. And they're not extraordinarily expensive, and they're very powerful in the way that they know how to get to the nub of the issue and help you find your solution. So, yeah, some of mine did go. I had a lovely childhood. I had parents who were fantastic, but I had things happen along the way that may have created a little bit of disturbance in my self-worth. And then business experiences, we get beaten up. And we start to limit our beliefs in ourselves as the result of that. And that's what we need to look at, because we need to have self-belief. We need to desire, have belief, and then get the knowledge and skills and take some actions. And often it means actually changing our mindset and some of the habits we have to really have the impact that we want on our life. And that might mean you need a little bit of support on that.
At what point did you begin public speaking?
Well, if you take me back to school, I was terrified. Even standing up and reciting a poem used to give me sleepless nights. So when we started the academy in 98, it was a very, it was a lovely community. It was a safe community. And we hosted events. We had 5,000 events across the world.
Jesus.
And we didn't host all of those every year. Members would host a lot of them, but we had big events in London. We had about 600 people would come to the Tower Hotel, or we ended up moving it to the Grosvenor Hotel at Victoria, and about 600 people would come a month. And Thomas used to host them. And then in I think it was 2003, somewhere around that, 2004, Thomas was traveling in Asia and I needed to stand up and host it, and it was, I remember it very clearly, but people responded very well. And then British BT, a lovely lady called Jane Swift, she was working at BT running the Women's Network, and she had heard about me and she asked me to come and speak. And that was a big leap, because that was going into an audience that didn't know me and into this very serious world of corporate life. But she gave me the confidence to be myself and talk about my story. That was good. And then it just grew from there. And then I had this wonderful moment, which I talk about in my book, where I was charging roughly around £2,000-£2,500 for a public speech. And then when we were really on our down, as life was really tough, I mean, it would take a lot to turn things around. I was asked to speak for an airline and go and talk to their cabin crew about entrepreneurship, because they wanted to encourage their cabin crew to go part time and be able to have an online business that they could do in any airport lounge around the world. And I had to submit a quote, and I said to Thomas, I've just written the quote, £2,500, but is it going to make any difference to our lives really now in the shit that we're in? Because this is going to be quite a lot of work to prepare. And he said, I don't know, Pen, you know. So I moved the decimal point, 1 point, to 25,000. And I submitted it. And 2 days later, they wrote back saying that they're delighted to have somebody of my caliber and gave me the order.
That's cool, isn't it?
And I think the message is that sometimes you have to take a risk. I know in my case, it was not really that huge a risk. But it is interesting if you get to a point, you know, it wasn't a huge risk because of where we were. But, you know, I think we have to get to a point where we choose, test a little bit, but we have to have the knowledge that we could risk losing something.
Jesus Christ, 25 grand for a speech. That's wicked.
Yeah, and can you imagine what that did for me? That was powerful. That paid a month's salaries for the staff.
So I suppose your reputation and your standing in the industry because of eCademy and everything you'd built up, you got yourself to that point where you could command that fee, basically.
Yeah, and that's why I so strongly believe in the importance of building a personal brand. Mm-hmm. People Google people, and it's amazing how many people have a Twitter account that's just their company name. But what happens when that company name isn't in? And also, you know, if I'm just following a company name, I can't relate to a company. I can relate to a person. So
yeah,
I do believe very strongly in building a personal brand, because it's the social capital around me over these years is what's kept me going, kept confidence going, etc.
It's a good hedge, isn't it? Like by building up a personal following, like you say,
yeah.
Because then people develop a connection and a liking and a trust to you personally, not just the business, like you say. That's, it's a very good hedge, because even if you lose the business, exactly like you just said, you've, and nobody can replicate you or copy you or compete with you. You know, if people like you, that there's only one of you, isn't there? You know,
exactly. It is great. And, you know, the fact that I'm following Ben Lowrey, you know, it's nice. It's nice to know people. And I think this is a people world now.
And then tell us about the OBE.
Oh, that's very kind of you. That was amazing. That was extraordinary. So that was in November 2013. I received notification that David Cameron had put me forward to the Queen. And would I accept an OBE? And they have to ask you that first, because some people are really anti them. You know, they don't like them for some reason. Anti-monarchy or something, I suppose. So, of course, I duly accepted it and was very thrilled. And in the March the 7th, the following year, 2014, we went to Windsor Castle, met the Queen, and was presented my OBE, which the citation for it was contribution to entrepreneurship in the digital economy.
Fantastic. Yeah.
Lovely. That's another piece of validation, and it's a bit like something that can never be taken away unless I did something horrendous, which I don't plan to.
And with the OBE, you can stick another zero on the end of that speaking fee as well.
Oh, God, that would be nice. Yeah.
And what point did you link up with Stellar Speakers and Neil and Joe?
Oh, that's such a lovely relationship. Well, I've known Kelly for a long while, who's involved in it, and she was an Academy member, so she approached me. And I have a couple of speaking agencies that react and contact me. They're on their my profile's on their site, and if somebody contacts them, but I've not had anybody really as like an agent that's promoting me. So that's really nice. That's a lovely. So that's relatively recent, and I'm really looking forward to working with them.
Do you aim your message at women entrepreneurs in particular, or is it both genders?
No, in fact, my latest mastermind is 9 men and 3 women, the one that I'm running now. Although the one I'm now recruiting for in October, a lot of women are coming forward. No, I'm much more interested in the energy that somebody puts out, not what gender they are. I think you can have very testosterone driven women, and you can have testosterone driven men. You can have female estrogen driven men and estrogen driven women. It's how you conduct yourself and communicate. And the mastermind and the people I like to work with are people that aren't too egotistical. They know that they've got an ambition. Maybe they've got a feeling of unrequited success. You know, they put a lot in and they're not getting it back. But I like to help people that have got some skills and are really good people, because life's short and I want to work with nice people. And I know that when I assemble a team of people in a room like a mastermind, if I like them, it's like putting a dinner party together. I'm going to enjoy spending the next 12 months with them, and so are the other people in the room.
So tell us about the mastermind in more detail. Like, what does it involve?
So masterminds were first talked about by Napoleon Hill, and it's really this beautiful thing of everybody in the room rising together. I like coaching and mentoring, but you know, that's relying on my my opinion and my skills and my connections. Whereas if you go in a room with 11 other great brains, which there's 12 people on our mastermind, so you enter it, we start on the same day together and we end on the same day. And there's a lot of accountability in that, because I want to know that I've given a return on the investment, and that wherever somebody starts at the end, they finish having grown, and their business performance is, and the formula in their business is a lot stronger. It's about business is personal. It follows the 12 chapters in a fairly casual way, because the real crux of it is, who are you in business and how are you performing in the business and life that you want? It's not about scaling your business to meteoric rights if you just want to increase your business by another 50,000 a year because you have reasons that you don't want to go beyond that. That's absolutely great, because that ambition is just as powerful as somebody who wants to go from 1 million to 5 million. To me, it's about what's your personal definition of success, and it's about you as a whole person. So, you know, how are you looking after yourself? How are you feeling about yourself? How do you show up inside your business? What skills and knowledge do you need in order to do the things that your business needs you to do?
And is it a regular ongoing thing, or is it like one weekend or what?
It's not. No, it's every month, once a month, a whole day in London. At the moment, we're running them in London. We're running two a year. So there's 24 places in the year. Thomas and I run it together.
Oh, by the way, I can hear those notifications coming through. Is that Skype or is it another app?
WhatsApp.
Oh, yeah. Perhaps. I don't know if you're able to close it.
Sorry.
If you can, don't worry if not. It's not the end of the world.
I've closed it now. So sorry about that.
That's okay. That's okay. So there's 24 places. You run two groups of a dozen people.
Mm.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. And then outside of that, we do some non-exec roles in companies. We do some personal mentoring, with people, and speaking. So it keeps us busy.
Yes.
We do work very hard, Thomas and I have to say. But I love my work. So, and our kids are grown up now, doing their own thing. So, it's exciting. I'm loving this stage of my life, I have to say. Yeah, I really do.
Do you have very clear, well-defined long-term goals, medium-term goals, or are you letting it unfold?
We have some big goals that we want to achieve in terms of security for our future. And those are quite defined. I think one of the things that I grew up in the 80s, and it was all about, set these big, hairy goals. But I think that, more we're aware of our brain chemistry, so the release of dopamine in our reward centers of our brain, the need to keep our serotonin levels up, to keep our mood better. I think we have to be careful of how we run our goals. So, for example, in the mastermind, there may be a nice big goal after the 12 months, but we have staged goals along it so that you get that hit of reward in your brain that you are getting there. So, yeah, you're absolutely right to call them short, medium and long term goals. And yes, I have those. And it helps me to pace myself. One of the big things last year was learning about how overwhelm happens and how to really respect the brain, the way the brain works, and how easy it is to overwhelm yourself. And so I pace, if as long as I've done that, then I can do this. And once I've done that, I can then do this. And so I might have a long list of things I need to do, but I'll get to those things once I've got to the first, second, third step. Yeah.
Mm. Who's been some of the most influential books or teachers or speakers or people you follow and look up to in your life?
Definitely Thomas has been the most influential. Now my kids are. I mean, it's a beautiful thing when your kids, they're all in their 20s. One's studying psychology at uni and he wants to become a performance psychologist. One is working in a large organization and wants to build an entrepreneurship program inside that company to encourage more innovation and autonomy within organizations. And one is an entrepreneur. Hannah's an entrepreneur in her own right. And they teach me so much because they're of this age. And so they are vital to me. But actually, I'm not a huge reader. And I'm not great at delegation. So I don't spend a lot of time having the joy of following people online and reading and watching YouTube channels. And when I relax, I watch crap. Okay, I'm going to tell you that. So I like to really chill. But going back, there was some fundamental books that meant a lot to me. So I read, before I started Academy, I read Permission Marketing by Seth Godin. Mm. I think that's powerful. That was before the internet, really. He wrote that. He sold his business to Yahoo. And Permission Marketing was really important to me because it talks about the very gentle stages of selling. So going from strangers to friends, friends to customers. And that was pre-internet. And then the other book I read that I liked was a more spiritual book called Celestine Prophecy.
Oh, yeah. I love that one. Yeah.
Yeah. And although I would say that he's not the greatest of writers, and I think sometimes you have to read at different stages in your life. So the first time I read it, it had massive impact. Second, I read it, I thought, and I think it depends on what frequency you're on in your own life when you read it. But I really like that. I like that. I really get that subject of consciousness and the rise in shared consciousness as well.
Mm, yeah. So, which part of the country are you based?
In Surrey, in Farnham.
All right. Yeah. Yeah. Mm. I teach handstands there sometimes. I go to
Really?
Yeah, I've taught at Nuffield in Farnham, and I go to Guildford as well, Guildford Spectrum. Yeah, I go all over the country, usually in leisure centres or gyms or village halls, different places.
So, oh, my son would love that because he loves doing handstands.
Oh yeah. How old is he?
He's 22 now.
All right. Well,
he's at uni, but he's coming back. So in the summer. If you're over in Guildford Way or whatever, yeah, he'd love that.
Oh, yeah, he's welcome to. I'm in Winchester this Sunday.
Oh, right.
So,
wow.
Yeah, it's one of the things I
do.
So
tell me, Ben, why do people want to learn how to do handstands? Tell me about that.
Well, it's basically just a show-off party trick, really, essentially. It's a good challenge that's cool and impressive. That's the honest.
But can anyone do it? Could I actually do it?
It is very difficult. It takes years to get it. It's not easy at all. It's very popular amongst yoga people. Most of the people that attend my workshops are yoga people. There's sometimes circus people and gymnastic people come along and CrossFit people. So
and
there's,
what is the benefit of it apart
there's,
from
there's no benefit? No, is
but there must be something core inside your body that once you can do it, your core muscles must be strong.
Not really. I think it's a mental, emotional challenge and accomplishment is mostly what it is. Yeah.
Did you do it in schools?
No, I only do it for adults, and I just do sort of one-off workshops at different locations.
That's an amazing niche.
Yeah, it's essentially a circus skill, even though it's popular amongst yoga people. It's circus hand balancing is what it is, really.
So are you on Instagram? Do you put videos of you doing
it? Yeah, I got a lot of content online, got a lot of tutorials and stuff. My website's called circoplex.com.
Oh, and are you on Instagram?
Yeah, Ben Lowrey.
In fact, I'm going to look you up, follow you. That's fantastic.
Funny enough, for the exact reason we were saying just now, I always do it under my own name, exactly like we were saying.
Brilliant, that's great.
So... And years ago, around 2006, 2007, I was doing online guitar lessons.
Yes. Neil told me that.
Yeah, I was a guitarist to begin with and then eventually built this online guitar. And I had a similar journey to you. I sort of built it and lost it, but in a much shorter span of time over a period of a couple of years. And it was doing really well at one point and I ended up going bankrupt, owing a massive amount of tax. So I can relate to, you know, aspects of your story as well, albeit on a smaller scale.
Yeah, well, you know, whatever scale it is, it's quite an awakening moment, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. In a funny kind of way, some people manage to get through without hitting any road bumps or hiccups, and I don't envy them, you know, because you can end up gliding and coasting along on a false sense of believing that everything you touch turns to gold, and there's an element of luck, you know, so, like sometimes you're just lucky and things go right, and it's partly your own, you know, hard work and diligence, and it's partly a bit of luck. And if you never discover how to fail, you know, you're at a disadvantage, really, you know.
Oh, I think you're absolutely right, and I think you've become smug as well, and I think there's a lot of smug people that are very hard to engage with. I think people are far richer in their personalities when they've had to overcome challenges. I really do.
I agree.
Yeah. You can't force someone into pain, you know, but we should embrace it. I mean, I always think happiness returns. And that feeling of happiness, when you've become happy again after a dark period, I think your notch of happiness is even greater.
Yes, there is a depth to people like in there that have been through stuff. There's
Hannah, I always said to my children on the first date I had Thomas and we talked about life, I said, I don't expect anybody to make me happy, that I've got to make myself happy. And so the children know that that's how I believe, you know, we have to take responsibility. I think some people get married and go into business, go into anything and think these people aren't making me happy. It's a personal responsibility. But then Hannah, after what she went through, she ended up going to Bali. And she wanted to become an entrepreneur, leave a large company after her the abuse that happened to her. And she went to Bali last year to set up her business out there and enjoy life out there for a year. And at the airport, she said to me, Mum, I know you always said to me, you've got to find your own happiness, but Mum, you also have to fight for it. And I think that's really important. I think there's a lot of people just put up with stuff. They're not fighting for their happiness. And it's very powerful.
So how's she getting on out there? Is she still out there?
No, she's back now. She's back. She's moving into her own place tomorrow, no, on Saturday in Farnham. And she's fantastic. She's amazing. She's a real inspiration to us all and people that she works with, because she's great. She's great.
I didn't quite catch. So what kind of work is it she's doing?
She actually helps people to build their personal brand.
Right.
And she's really studied it very, very closely and built a fantastic formula to sit one-to-one with people and work through it and drill things down and then have your brand ready so that it's a really congruent brand, and it's all, you've got everything around your brand that enables you then to build a powerful sales funnel and understand yourself and do what is right for you.
Oh, great.
Because she's been my coach, actually, because I had a brand, Penny Power, but it was related to Academy or related to Digital Youth Academy, and then I needed to start generating revenue and work out how to become Penny Power and what I would sell. And you have to make it easy for people to know how to do business with you. And so she really, so she's launched my latest site for with me, helping me to design and build that, find the messaging and also a landing page and stuff like that. So she's tremendous and she loves doing it. So she takes on 4 clients a month, puts a lot into them.
What's her website?
hannahpower.co.uk.
Okay. And I'm conscious of your time, Penny, because I know you've got other appointments after this call. Are you okay for a few more questions?
I am. I love it. I appreciate all your time, Ben.
Yeah, no, it's great. I mean, for me, this is so much fun on so many levels. I mean, I enjoy the conversations. I learn from the conversations. I build my own brand in the process of doing the podcast. You know, so for me, it ticks a lot of boxes doing this.
It's great.
I was going to ask, what's instinctively your most proud or fond memory of your entire sort of business career over the last 20 years? Like, what's the memory that jumps out of your fondest moment?
Gosh, that's such a nice question. And actually, I was thinking, Christ, will I remember able to remember one? But actually, I think it was Academy's 10th birthday party. Mm. So that was in 2008. It was just before life became very tough for us. And there was, I'm not exaggerating to say there were nearly 1,000 people in the room. We didn't realize how many people would come to it. And it was beautiful. It was just stunning. And the children came and my father and mother came, and the members were amazing. People were really on fire with their own businesses, enjoying the community. It was gorgeous. So I think it would be that. It was a fantastic, fantastic time of my life, that.
Is there photos? Presumably there is.
Yeah, there is. And there was a video done and everything. I'd have to dig it out. Yeah.
I had a question in my mind then, and it just left. But I was gonna, what was I getting at? I've forgotten what I was gonna say. But I think, do you plan? I mean, I get that you enjoy the stuff. Oh, you know, I know what I was gonna ask you. I was gonna say, what's your ideal kind of audience that you like to speak to? I mean, is it the bigger the better, or is it a certain kind of people?
I think the energy of a room, a lot of people, is really exciting. I think it's very hard to do a broadcast style thing with a very few amount of people, because it's the energy that you need to feed off. So I've been to some events where people were really disappointed, you know, that they've set up an expo in a town or something and not many people came, and you ended up with 3-4 people, and we then sat down and had a gorgeous time in a very interactive way, having a conversation. And I think it's really about, when I'm hired, it's the culture that the people who are running it want to create. So I've just taken a brief for a wonderful event for an SAP company in June, and it's 2 HR people. And I'm really excited about that, because their energy is about the people and how their product can help to increase the well-being in an organization. That, to me, is a lovely brief. So I think it's the intention of the energy of the room. I'm very, very put off by the back of the room selling type events. And then I'm speaking at the business show tomorrow, which is a twice a year event. That's quite tough because it's amazing people in the room that want knowledge, and but it's done in one of those huge halls where you've just got these partitioned rooms, so you've got this massive noise at the back of the exhibition, and you're trying to engage with a group of maybe 100 people in a room. So but I'm pretty adaptable now because I know how to adapt myself to the audience and the energy, and I can feel energy in a room. I can feel the hot spots and things. So I think that comes with experience, really, doesn't it, and the confidence you have.
And what role is Tom playing? Is he also doing public speaking as well?
Yeah, he is. I mean, Thomas is a really phenomenal futurist. He's really, he loves technology, so he's always seeing things. So he was got into blockchain and crypto very, very early and is being celebrated in that. He's got a book called Tokenomics on that subject. So he speaks on that subject. And he has some communities on WhatsApp and does some very specialized dinners that are lovely. People come along for a more intimate dinner. Twice a month he does those. And then he and I are working on the mastermind together. And what's going to be very exciting is we're creating an alumni group from that and the people we mentor. So then it will be very small events with those people to start to create a community again, but very intimate again, because we really believe in what we first built in the academy. Yeah.
Wonderful. That's fascinating stuff. And so if people want to follow you and find out more about your mastermind, where should they go?
So I've just set up a landing page, so we could test that out, which would be great. But I think by the time this goes out, it will be well and truly in its flow. And it's called pennypower.co.uk/free-chapter. And there you can get a free chapter of my book and go into my mailing list. I'm on Twitter at Penny Power. I'm on LinkedIn and Facebook. And Thomas and I have a Facebook group that's, if you search Penny and Thomas, there's a Facebook group now that we're just about to launch as well. So there's lots of ways people get in touch. And then my book's available on Amazon, or you can buy it on my website, which is more expensive than Amazon because Amazon do love to discount. But I would sign it and post it off personally to you.
Oh, wonderful. Okay. Well, that's great. I've really enjoyed talking to you, Penny. Thanks for
taking
the time.
And you, Ben. Thank you. It was really lovely. Really lovely.
You're welcome. I'll send you, I'll upload this maybe today or tomorrow, and I'll send you all the links.
Fantastic.
Okay. All right. Thanks.
Good to get to know you.
Yeah. And I'll speak to you again in future.
Lovely. Bye-bye.
All right. Bye-bye.